Let's say you want to do something 10 times. And there you go. But I mentioned earlier that there's a much better and cleaner way to do it. Here it is. This does exactly the same thing. It's all on one line. It looks a lot clearer, but what's really going on here? Well, this 10, like everything in Ruby, is an object. We know that we can call methods on an object by putting a period after it, and then the name of the method, and then an argument list, which in this case we don't need, so we've left the parentheses off. And then we come to this curly bracket. This is a feature of Ruby known as a block. You can put one or more statements inside the block, and it gets passed as another argument to the method. So in this case we're saying, we want you to execute this code 10 times, and that's exactly what Ruby does. We also looked at iterating over a list. I happen to have here a list of Alfreds. If you want to iterate over them, you use the method each. You may be able to figure out what's going on here based on the syntax you're already familiar with. The puts is printing out a string. The string is doing interpolation with this variable name. And name is mentioned here. This syntax is unfamiliar. We've got the vertical bars here. This is almost exactly like an argument to a method. Name is assigned each value of the list in turn, and the block is executed once for each list element. So it executes four times. This is known as iteration. This is a very common operation in programming, and Ruby makes it very easy and very easy to read. There's one subtle difference, which is the argument is actually optional. Earlier, when I called the times method, I didn't use the argument. I just completely left it out. In this case, I'm putting the argument in there, and you can see that the times method first calls the block with n equal to 0, and then 1, and then 2, up to 9, just the same as our while loop did. I'm also using a semicolon here to put two statements in. Ruby lets you put multiple statements together on a line, so this is one way you could put two statements together in a block, although there's a much cleaner syntax, which is to use do instead of the curly brackets. Apart from the fact that it uses do and end instead of curly brackets, and the fact that it lets you put things in multiple lines, it's actually exactly the same. Here are some more examples. That's counting upward. That's counting downward. These are good examples showing that you can pass a regular argument into the method and the block. Or we can use a range object. And now we're iterating over the contents of the range. Well, so far, all of these examples have been taking advantage of only the side effect. I've just been printing things, but I haven't done anything with the return value. There's another method, collect, which executes the block. In this case, there's no side effect. Nothing's being printed, nothing is being affected outside of the code. We're just going to take the value that was passed in and square it. And what you get back is a list containing all the results. So for every element of input, you have a corresponding element of output. This is all very cool and interesting, but it gets better. There's a function, lambda, which accepts a block and produces an object. Everything in Ruby is an object, including a block. In this case, it's called a proc. Once you have it as an object, you can call it, pretty much exactly like calling a method. There's also a shortcut syntax using the square brackets. Now, what can you do with this? Well, for one thing, you can use this ampersand syntax to pass the block into a method. So if I needed to pass the same block into multiple methods, I could do that using the syntax without having to repeat the block over and over again. Say we have another one. And another. Since they're objects, and since an array can hold any object, I can put these lambdas, these procedures, into an array. And now I can iterate over that list. Within the block, I'm going to iterate again over this. I'm going to pass it a reference to the block from the list. So you see what's happening here is we have a list with three elements, each of which is a list with five elements. So we have the result of calling the first procedure, the second procedure, and the third one. That may have blown your mind a little, but if so, just rewind and watch it again. It'll make sense. In the meantime, here's an example of how to use a block in your own code. Note that I didn't have to put anything in the argument list explicitly to say that I want to accept a block as an argument. All I have to do is use the statement yield somewhere inside it, and this becomes the argument list to the yield. In this case, I'm just passing the one argument, although blocks can have multiple arguments too. So I'm going to call it, I'm going to pass in a block. The block will accept a string. The string is passed into gibberish. I add a space on the end of it, multiply it by 3 so we get 3 of them, and print the exclamation marks on the end. And because yield is called 3 times with 3 different values, the block gets executed 3 times with each of those values. If our block is returning a value instead of producing side effects, we can use the return value from the yield. Here's an example of doing that. I'm going to pass in a block. Now I want you to pause at this point and try to predict what the answer is going to be. All right? There's the answer. Why is that? Inflate gets called with a 6. That becomes the value of n. Then inflate needs to evaluate this expression. It needs to know what yield is equal to. To do that, it needs to know what n plus 1 is equal to. So first it adds 1 to the 6 and gets 7. Then it calls yield with the 7. That calls the block. Here's the block. This n in the block takes on the value 7, which is squared, to produce 49. So the yield produced a value of 49. Then we multiply that by 10, and we get 490, and that's the result of calling inflate.